We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Our souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me damned. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other bounds I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Whoa. Shackled me, how infinite that grace divine. I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other bounds I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Upon your heart, no, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow.
Well, hello there, everybody. This is Easter week, and I just wanted you to know that we've got some questions. So we found some local experts, and we thought we would ask them these questions. This is what we found out. What do you like about Easter?
Finding Easter eggs.
Dying eggs.
I like going Easter egg hunting.
That the Easter bunny comes.
The Bible story.
that Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead.
Who is Jesus?
He's like an amazing person.
Jesus is God.
The Son of God.
The Messiah, who died for our sins.
He's the Lord.
God's Son that He sent down from heaven. His one and only Son that He sent down from heaven to die on the cross for us.
Jesus is God's Son. He died on the cross to save us from our sins.
Jesus is the Son of God, and He was brought down to the earth to save us from our sins.
He is our heavenly Savior who lives in heaven.
What do you think Jesus looked like?
A person.
Can you show me a picture? Yeah, go get a picture.
He looks like a man with a long beard.
Well, a lot of people say he has a beard, so he probably did have long hair since there were no form of cutting. So probably had long hair and a beard.
Jesus looks like a young man and he saves people.
Who were the disciples?
Jesus' helpers.
The followers of Christ.
God's followers. The 12 disciples.
Peter, James, John, Bartholomew, Andrew, Matthew, Simon the Zealot, Thaddeus, Thomas. I know there's a couple more, but I don't know.
The disciples were the group of 12 that followed Jesus around, and he taught them how to he told them that they were gonna be his disciples and help others become disciples and preach about him.
What did Jesus teach?
Jesus taught kids.
Love.
The Bible.
Good stuff about Him. Good stuff about God.
All mankind to kind of be like a Christian.
Taught the people to follow Him.
Jesus taught the Word of God, and he taught people how to, and if people if people had questions, he would tell them a parable to explain their question, the answer to their question.
He taught people about himself and about God and the way to live.
What kinds of miracles did Jesus do?
He fed a bunch of people out of 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish.
Good miracles, like when he was in the boat and he was sleeping and there's a big storm, he just said, make a rainbow. He rose that guy from the dead. He healed the poor, he healed the blind man.
What do you think would be a really cool miracle that he could do now?
Heal the blind. Make the unicorns come to life. Let sports start back.
Wander around the house.
That he could bring people back from the dead.
Make me a superhero.
It would be cool if there was a stick that was snapped in half. He just goes, and it's just like a full stick again.
if he came down from heaven and took everybody that liked him up into heaven?
All I can say is really come down from heaven and save us, which he's gonna do.
What did they eat at the Last Supper?
Oh, bread.
Grapes.
Pasta salad.
Fish and bread.
Bread. 2 loaves of bread and 5 fish.
Probably like a turkey leg.
5 loaves of bread and 2 fish.
They ate bread and they broke it together. And
unleavened bread and grape juice.
Why did some people not like Jesus?
Because they didn't want him to preach the truth.
Because they didn't believe in him.
Because they just didn't love him and they didn't believe in him.
Because they were bad guys.
Because they didn't like people following him.
Because he was a good person. And wait, didn't they not like that he was the Son of God? And they had other beliefs in God, and they didn't like it that it wasn't son of their fake gods.
Because some people didn't believe that he was the Son of God, and they didn't think he was able to say your sins are forgiven, or they just didn't believe in him.
What did those people do to Jesus?
Take him away?
Put nails in him and made him put nails in his feet on the cross. And someone made the cross and they put nails on the feet, on his feet. And he put thorns in his head and he was bleeding and nails in his hands and then his body was still there.
But what happened on Easter Sunday morning?
He was healed.
He rose from the dead.
He rose from the dead.
He rose again.
He rose from the dead.
He pushed the gravestone away. One of the disciples was like, found Jesus, and then after that, he went up to heaven.
What did the disciples do when they saw Jesus?
They were like, whoa.
They were scared.
They bowed down and worshiped him in amazement.
They were probably really confused.
Okay, so what does that look like?
How do we follow Jesus?
By listening to him.
By following the disciples' steps until loving him.
We pray and follow his words.
You pray with Jesus.
We learn about him, we go to church, we do stuff he'd want us to do. We believe in him, we pray to him. We read the Bible.
Okay.
We be nice, and we teach people about Jesus. And some people, they don't believe in him, because whatever, we can teach them.
We let our light shine.
By getting baptized.
We follow Jesus by reading the Bible and doing what he told us to do, preaching about him and praising him.
Why did Jesus do all of this?
For us.
Because he was nice.
because he's very nice.
For our sins. To save us from our sins so we don't have to go to hell because he loves us.
Because he was perfect.
To forgive us for our sins.
Because he loved us. We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love Jesus.
We love Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
Today, Jesus.
Taught the sun where to stand in the morning? Who taught the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, Amazing grace will always be my song of joy, for it was grace that fought my victory. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died for me.
He died for me.
How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond
Well, today is Easter Sunday morning, the day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And you know, what a wonderful day it is. It's a day that in the midst of all of the confusion and troubles that we face in this world, it reminds us that we can have hope because our Savior lives. Now, this year, the year 2021, every Sunday morning, we have been looking in the book of Matthew. And the purpose for doing this is so that we can hopefully solve a puzzle or connect dots. We're talking about creating a picture of what it means to be a true follower of Jesus Christ. Whether you call it being a Christian, a believer, a Christ follower, what we really and truly desire is for our life to resemble that of Christ. Well, this morning, instead of reading all of the usual passages of Scripture that we share on Easter Sunday, I want us to take this service from a little different vantage point. I want us to look at it through the eyes of the writer Matthew. And I want us to follow his journey with Jesus from the time that he becomes a follower through the resurrection of Christ. And I want us to be able to see and spot some of the things that truly changed his life. Now, we're going to begin by looking at something that he recognized right away. And that was the fact that the love of Jesus Christ calls out to all sinners. Let's look at Matthew chapter 9, beginning in verse 9. It says, as Jesus went from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him, and Matthew got up and followed. Now, Matthew was a tax collector, and you're saying, big deal. What does that have to do with anything? Well, having a vocation such as tax collector in the days of Jesus would have meant several things. It would have meant that Matthew would have been viewed by many with contempt and distrust. It means that he would have been despised by a lot of his fellow citizens. Then, one fateful day, he hears the call of Jesus to come and follow.
And he leaves behind all of the old life, and he willingly follows the Master, never, ever to be the same again. Now, that is a salvation story. It's a story like many that has been told over and over and over again. It may be a lot like your salvation story. Maybe not the same situations, maybe not the same feelings that Matthew was going through, but yet you have a story of a day that you felt the call of Jesus drawing you to Him. And you realized that there was something special about what He was asking you to do. And so you surrendered your life to Him. You sought forgiveness of your sins, and you accepted the risen Savior into your heart and life to be changed forever. You know, we read many times throughout the Scriptures of individuals whose story may have been similar but may have been worlds apart from yours or from Matthew's. One such individual that always comes to mind is someone that, came to be known as the Apostle Paul. Paul was one whose motives and desires and attitudes were controlled by what he thought was right, controlled by the way that he had been taught you should live in order to be able to please God. Paul was one who was so misguided that instead of really loving as Jesus was commanding individuals to do, he sought to destroy anyone that didn't see things his way. And so what he does is he goes on a quest to stop Christianity. Then one day he meets the Master. And he tells his conversion story, and he explains how the love of God was able to transform him and forgive him no matter how vile, how wrong, how evil, how sinful he may have been. In Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse 6, Paul explains just real briefly how he felt. He said, "You see, at just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." The second thing that we see from the Scriptures in Matthew is that Jesus not only calls out to those who are lost, who are sinners, but He also calls out to those who are tired and who are weary. And I think back over the last year and all of the struggles, or some of the struggles that we've been through, many of those struggles together. And I think, well, a couple of words that could pretty much describe how we feel this morning is tired and weary. So how does Matthew fit into this? Well, in this passage of Scripture, between the time that Matthew decides to follow Jesus in chapter 9 and our second text, which we're going to read in a moment from chapter 11, we find that this converted sinner has witnessed so many different life-changing events that just demonstrate the power of Jesus. He saw these things firsthand. For instance, in chapter 9, he sees Jesus raise the dead, heal the blind, cast out demons, heal the sick. In chapter 10, we see that Matthew is one that Jesus also gives the authority to go out into the world and do pretty much the same thing that he has witnessed Jesus do. Now, you think of someone who is a new believer. You think of the experiences that they have with other believers or their experience in their walk with Christ. And I don't know if any of us could say, wow, we witnessed the things that Matthew was able to witness. But you know, even though it was an exciting life, especially considering where he came from, those of us that have ever taken part in ministry, we know something. And that doesn't, I mean, that sounds kind of arrogant, but I don't mean it that way. I mean, you have come to understand that in the midst of every victory, there's a whole lot of struggle that goes hand in hand with it. Struggles before the victory, struggles after the victory. And you know that Matthew had left behind all of these things to follow the Lord. And in the midst of all of the good that he sees happening, he, along with the other disciples, dealing with the multitudes that were always following Jesus, you know they saw those who were tired and weary. And it's Matthew who records some of the most beautiful words of the Lord, a powerful invitation that we have used, many of us have used in our daily walk. It's found in chapter 11 of Matthew. It begins in verse 28 where Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Wow. "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." So Matthew has witnessed with his eyes, well, the call of Jesus to him in his life of sin, drawing him to the Master. We see that he has journeyed through this walk on earth with Jesus. He has witnessed how not just the lost were brought in, but those who were weary, burdened, tired, and how Jesus calls out to them to come to him. That's great, isn't it? Well, the third thing that we see is the love of Christ calls out not just to the lost, not just to the weary, but he calls out to his followers. And you say, "Well, Pastor, we've already been called. We've already accepted the call to follow Jesus. What is he calling us to do?" Well, here's where the resurrection story comes in. You know, when we read through the Gospels and we read about those days leading up to the arrest of Jesus, the trial, the crucifixion, the death, the burial, you know, we can see and spot and read some of the things that the disciples were facing. We don't know what each one of them struggled with. We don't know how they reacted. We're told of some accounts like those of Peter and those of John. But yet, where was Matthew during all of this? What was going on? Well, we take up on that resurrection Sunday, Matthew's account, chapter 28, beginning in verse 1. Listen to what Matthew writes. "Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and rolled aside the stone and sat on it. His face shone like lightning and his clothes was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him and they fell into a dead faint. The angel spoke to the women, 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead just as he said he would. Come, see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you.' The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were frightened, but they were filled with great joy, and they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. As they went, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they ran to him, grasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there.'" A firsthand account of an adventure, an encounter with the risen Savior. A firsthand account of the love of Jesus in action, the care, the concern that he has for those who follow him. It's these individuals, the lost, the weary, the followers, that Jesus calls out in love, "Come to me. Come to me and you will be changed. If you're lost in your sins, Jesus will bring forgiveness to you if you ask. If you are a believer, a follower of Christ, and all of the pressures of the world, all of the events of the past couple of years are weighing on you, some of you may be at wit's end today, not knowing what you're going to do or where you're going to go from here, Jesus is calling, "Come to me and I will give you rest." For followers today, it's easy to be afraid. It's easy to listen to all of the reports and the news agencies and to hear what's going on in the world. And it's easy to wring your hands and become so filled with fear. Jesus is calling out, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. There's a plan in place. Just be faithful. Today, he calls to us to come and be healed, to receive rest, to receive guidance. He calls out to us to believe and be free. So in the beginning, I said, in the midst of all of life's struggles, we can rejoice today. We can have hope. You say, how can we do all of these things? There's a song we sing a lot around Easter time. It's a song that's words are very powerful. It says, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear of His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives salvation to impart. You ask me how, I know He lives. He lives within my heart. On this Easter Sunday morning, your life can be changed. Jesus will come and live in you if you just invite Him to come in. I want to say a word of prayer with you. Whether you're gathered here in the sanctuary or whether you're watching at home, I want you to open your heart to the Lord. I came to the conclusion early this morning that that all of us fall into one of those categories. We're either, well, sitting at the tax collector's booth, living in our world of sin, or we've already answered the call and we're following, but we're tired. Or else, we need to hear the Lord say, don't be afraid, I'm in control. So as I pray this morning, wherever you are, whatever your hearts need, why don't you open your life to Jesus? Let's pray together. Jesus, today we do celebrate the fact that You are alive, that You are our risen Savior, that Your word has been so true and so right on point for all of us. And today, Lord, we open our life to You. As we celebrate, as we rejoice in the fact that we know You're alive, we also take comfort in knowing that we can face whatever life throws our way because You live. And so I pray that today, this Easter Sunday 2021, would be a time that many could look back on and say, well, my salvation account happened on this day. My life was changed on this day. Lord, today would You just change hearts and change lives as we march forward celebrating You, our risen Savior. Jesus, guide and direct us from this point on, for we ask it in Your mighty, holy name. Amen.